Sports Personality of the Year, the Laureus Sports Awards, Sunday Times Sportswoman of the Year, Sports Journalist Association Awards. Well, it is that time of year. And don't think of this as a bandwagon podcast, more a new annual event for the discerning Olympic and Paralympic sport enthusiast. It is the inaugural Anything But Footy Awards. It's an event set to rival Spectacle Wearer of the Year, Rear of the Year, and maybe the Brits, as the one they all want to win. I'm Michael.
And I'm John, and in the next half an hour or so, we'll discuss the winners and maybe losers of 2019 as sporting capacity. If it was the world, we'd be here all day. Here are the categories, then. We are having British sportsmen, and then best sportsman across the world, best British sportswoman and sportswoman across the world, best British team, and then sports team of the year, and best British moment and best sporting moment around the world.
They might be the same.
They could well be the same, or some might be others. To celebrate, we've come to the Gunmakers pub in Eyre Street Hill in Clerkenwell. So firstly, Michael, cheers.
Happy Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
This is the Anything But Footy Christmas party and awards. And there's you and me here, and a glittering array of sporting talent, theatre of the mind and all that. Some of the big sports personalities and teams that have really made up the sporting year that was 2019. And it's been another terrific sporting year.
It has. There might be a few, sorry, they can't make it. So they've asked me to collect the award at this time. Where should we start?
I think we start, as you say there, with the award for our best British sportsman. Now, obviously, as I mentioned right at the start, there's been plenty of award ceremonies over the past few weeks, past couple of months. And some of the names that have been picking up the gongs this time of year, Ben Stokes, Jonathan Ray, Lewis Hamilton, Shane Lowry, Adam Peaty, Alan Wynne-Jones and others.
Yeah, it's a strong British flavour, obviously, for British sportsmen. And also, when you look at who you're voting for, and we, both of us, were honoured to be on the panel for the Laureus World Sports Awards, which will be announced in February. So I've kind of got the person that I think should win it. And then my heart is telling me that somebody else will win it.
Yeah, I agree with you there. I've also, in this category, think that we probably underestimated the achievements of Lewis Hamilton, who wouldn't, I have to say, first and foremost, would be my best British sportsman of the year. If anything, if we were handing out some kind of lifetime achievement gong, I think Lewis Hamilton would be right up there. F1 world champion for the sixth time, so he's one behind Schumacher now. He won half of this season's races for Mercedes. He's won 83 Grand Prix in total. Schumacher's record is 91.
It's just boring, though.
It is, and you have to also, and this is to take nothing away from, obviously, clearly a magnificent driving talent, but technology plays such a big part in what he does. So whilst I think Lewis Hamilton's achievements over the last decade are fantastic, and I'm not a big F1 fan, to be honest, and I do think they've been slightly underestimated with everything else that's gone on this year, I do think he deserves an honourable mention. If this was my kid's school assembly, he'd be going up and getting a merit award.
I think that's fair enough. I think that he would be my third on the list for this. And my second and third, my first and second, I can't really decide. So I'm going to stick with my Anything But Footy hat, and we're doing the Anything But Footy Awards. So for me, Adam Peaty beats Ben Stokes.
Yeah, and, you know, I mentioned a few other names there. You've got Alan Wynne-Jones, you know, terrific captain of the Welsh Rugby Union side, captain of the Grand Slam, player of the year. For me, comes up a bit short because they were World Cup semi-finalists. I know it's a very high bar, but these are the inaugural Anything But Footy Awards. Shane Lowry, I love the golf, as you know. Four brilliant days watching the Open in Northern Ireland.
And an Irishman winning in Ireland, and it was the first time the Open had gone back since 52.
Something like that, and won it in terrific style as well. Two rounds of 67, course record in the third round where essentially he won it, 63. He won by six shots, and remember he started the season with only sort of partial status. So that's why he's on my list. And talking of Irishmen, Jonathan Ray, of course. Again, like Lewis Hamilton, I think his achievements underestimated. World Superbike Championship for the fifth time, so puts him ahead of Carl Fogarty, holds the record now for most race wins. But I come down, like you, to the same two people, and I find it very difficult to separate Ben Stokes and Adam Peaty. So I'll put the case for Ben Stokes forward, okay, first of all, and then you put Adam Peaty forward.
Okay.
And then we'll clink our glasses and move on. Ben Stokes won the Cricket World Cup for England, not single-handedly, and I think that maybe is why some people were edged towards Adam Peaty, because it's a team game. But what a dramatic way to win the Cricket World Cup. I mean, we're going to return to this, I'm sure, when we talk about everything else that was going on that afternoon, because it was the same afternoon as the men's final at Wimbledon. But to go to a super over, to go to the last ball, this is extra time, penalties.
And England were dead and buried.
Yeah.
When he came into bat.
And his achievements, you know, at Lord's on that afternoon were absolutely fantastic. And then he followed it up, of course, with the Ashes. And I know, you know, England didn't win the Ashes. Australia retained the Ashes. But that third test triumph, yeah, albeit without Steve Smith in the Australian side, who was missing with concussion, an unbeaten 135. It was a one-wicket stand. Again, cricket's not one of my big sports. But that, for me, elevates Ben Stokes in this category, because it's not one of my big sports. But like everyone else, I was into cricket in the summer, you know, and with all the other sporting events going on, and I know where I was that afternoon, it was watching neither the cricket or the Wimbledon. I was in Stockton-on-Tees Town Centre watching John Archibald win a cycling race. But that's besides the point. But the fact that Ben Stokes inspired lots of people to follow cricket that maybe hadn't done, and the fact it was such a special afternoon with Wimbledon as well happening at the same time, and John Archibald in Stockton, of course, that's why I think he will be ahead of a lot of people's lists.
So that leads us to Adam Peaty, and this man should have been nominated for Sports Personality of the Year.
Yep.
He is the greatest British swimmer ever. He's won more World Championship gold medals than anybody else. And he has been setting his own challenges, because he's been so far ahead of every other breaststroker in the world, that he's had to set his own targets to keep him motivated, to keep him going for more glory at Tokyo 2020, no doubt. And this year he beat his own 57 challenge, where he is the first ever person to swim under 57 seconds across 100 metres in the pool in the breaststroke. He also continually stands up against drug cheats. He backed Duncan Scott for his podium protest in the World Championships, and has been really vocal about, you know, if you take drugs or you're found to cheat, then you shouldn't be in the sport. And then he's also been this whole ISL, International Swimming League, campaigner, supporter, really took it to the governing body of swimming, FINA, and said, what you're doing for us is not enough and we need something different. And it was great for him to do that. Now, on the flip side of it, it's not Olympic year. So he is a world champion. A three-time world champion. Just for this year alone. But it's not an Olympic year. And next year in Tokyo will be bigger. But I think he'll face the same challenges that he did this year, which is why he's not nominated for Spotty, is because there will be other athletes who will be seen to be, if they win a gold medal, seen to be a bigger profile than Adam Peaty. But I think that he is our best British sportsman. He is so dedicated, so focused on delivering for himself and for Britain and bringing that gold medal back next year, that I can't see any other result.
Now, I know I put the case for the defence of Adam Peaty against Adam Peaty for Ben Stokes, but I think if you were to push me on it, I would agree with you for all the reasons you stated, not just his performance in the pool, but what he's done for his sport outside on the issues of the ISL and the staging of that, and what he's done for doping as well. So I think on the first category of best British sportsman, we clink the glasses and we agree.
Yes.
Adam Peaty for you and me.
Right, one down.
One down, seven to go. And we'll go to international sportsman now.
So a few of the people that I put down on my Laureus Sports Awards were Eliud Kipchoge.
Yep.
The first person ever to run the marathon under 2 hours. Wasn't a race, though. It was a staged event.
With technology and everything else helping him.
And the shoes.
Yep.
Tiger Woods.
2019 Masters champion. First major championship win in 11 years.
It's a heck of a comeback. We actually did a whole podcast themed on comebacks, didn't we? After that amazing result in March, when he just came from nowhere Tiger Woods. I know he's been on the comeback trail and been on the PGA Tour for the last few years, but never really looked like he was going to win a major. And I think he came in and did that. And then to win another PGA title this year, it shows it wasn't a fluke.
Mm.
So I think he is up there. But I think maybe it's more of a moment rather than Sportsman of the Year. So it could be the moment later in our awards. And then for me, I've put Rafa Nadal as another option. You know I'm a massive tennis fan.
Yep.
And I've watched it since growing up. I had the pleasure of covering Wimbledon a couple of times as well, which is a unique competition. But it's not just about Wimbledon. He has now won 12 Grand Slam French titles. He's the first person to ever hold 12 Grand Slams of the same competition, which is incredible. And everyone said he was finished a few years ago. They literally said his knees are gone and he was finished. And he, over the winter, he changed his serve and he's come back stronger and stronger and stronger. Not only did he win the French Open, he won the US Open. And he single-handedly is a bit harsh on the other players, but the Davis Cup in Madrid, the new look Davis Cup, you know, he played doubles and singles. He was a machine. And,
yeah, reminiscent of what Andy Murray did for Great Britain in 2015. People didn't see the new look Davis Cup this year. Rafa Nadal's contribution to it was what Andy Murray did when Great Britain won it a few years back. Andy Murray, people said then, single-handedly dragged his nation through. That was under the old format, of course. But that was the kind of level of achievement we're talking about with Rafa Nadal. So those are some individual sportsmen that we've mentioned. I just want to mention a couple from teams.
Yep.
Steve Smith, already had a mention, the Australian cricketer. Yep. They retained the Ashes. He came back from concussion.
Well, he came back from the cheating allegations, of course,
the bigger allegations, you know. But if you look back at that Ashes series, 774 runs. That's an average of 110.
Are you not a cricket fan?
And I'm not a cricket fan. but again, even I can see that those statistics are pretty impressive.
He was a machine as well.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we talk about single-handedly dragging teams through. What a talisman he has been for Australian cricket. And the other one I would mention would be Siya Kolisi, the first black captain of the Springboks. Of course, South Africa winning the Rugby Union World Cup final, beating England in the final 32-12. And what a unifying figure in South African sport. So I think for his achievements on the field, clearly captaining, and he was an excellent captain and leader. We spoke a lot about leadership in 2019 on our Great British Bosses podcast that we do. And I probably had underestimated how important leadership in a team and an organisation has been since I met those leaders in British sport. And what a leader he was for the South African team and the South African nation as well. So I think he's got to be on that list. But I'm going to go back, and I don't think we spoke about it enough, to the first name that you mentioned, Eliud Kipchoge.
Well, he's so quick that I couldn't keep up with him.
Well, he won four London marathons. He didn't win four London marathons this year. That would be an amazing achievement. He won his fourth London marathon. But I think we all think about what happened in Vienna, where the track and everything was set up, and the light show and the shoes and everything.
And it was
else.
Run at the right, most
pacemakers,
best time,
and all the rest of it. But aside from all that, and you know, that's technology's there in every sport,
everything that we do in life.
Yeah, and in strategy is there, and you know, even the 100-meter sprint, the purest thing, if you like. You know, you're still wearing the thinnest vest technology. You're still wearing the special shoes and all the rest of it. So you can't say, oh, well, it was all technology based, because that's in every sport. In football, in cricket, you choose your bat.
Tennis rackets. We'd be playing with wooden rackets.
So to run 26.2 miles in 1 hour, 59 and 40 seconds. And we talked about Adam Peaty earlier going under 57 seconds. Mm. You've got to put the sub 2 hour marathon with the 4 minute mile and the sub 10 second 100 meters. It will be something we will talk about for a generation, and that's why I will put him as my international sportsman of the year.
Well, I'm going to stick with Rafa Nadal, so we're going to have to agree to disagree.
Okay,
on
that's
this
fair
one.
Enough. Fair enough.
So a combined Sportsman of the Year for Nadal and Kipchoge. And I think, you know, for different reasons, they've really shown that they are incredibly world-class athletes. And, you know, I think it'll be interesting to see whether they can both carry it on in 2020.
Yeah, you're listening to the inaugural Anything But Footy Awards. We're in the Gunmakers in Clerkenwell on Eyre Street Hill, near to Farringdon Station. We're essentially having our Christmas party, so we've both got a pint of something fizzy on the go, and we're just running through our awards, and we're up to Category 3. Category 3 for the Best British Sportswoman of the Year. Now, we probably don't need to major on this too much, because if people are regular listeners, yes, they'll know we've talked at length when the Sports Personality Award nominations were out. We talked about Dina Asher-Smith against Katarina Johnson-Thompson. We talked about both with the Sunday Times Sportswoman of the Year Awards. Now, the one name that didn't really enter those discussions because she wasn't on the list, but the name that I would put right up there, is Alice Tye. 7 gold medals at the Paraswimming World Championships in London. Most decorated athlete of the event. 5 individual titles, 2 world records as well. I think anyone that wins 7 medals, 7 gold medals at one championship.
At a world. It wasn't a European, it was a world.
A world level is pretty special, isn't she?
Yeah, I think she is, and I think she's been underrated in the terms of looking back at the year. And I was fortunate enough to go to those championships, admittedly for a day, but it was a great atmosphere in the Aquatic Centre. It always is.
London staged it really well at short notice.
Yep, they kind of came to the rescue of the para swimming championships, and she performed, and every day she delivered. And I'm disappointed that she hasn't quite got the recognition in the wider media, because she was recognised in the Sunday Times for disability sportsman of the year.
And British Swimming named her ahead of Adam Peaty, as you correctly pointed out on a recent episode of Anything But Footy, as their swimmer of the year. So within the sport, she's been recognised. Yeah. And if Adam Peaty's finding it difficult to break through to the general public, she's finding it even more difficult. There has obviously been with her some issues over categorisation, and that's always going to be a talking point in para sport. So she was in the S10 category in Rio, where she won a bronze medal. She's now in the S8 category, which brought her up against Jessica Long, who was a legendary American Paralympian, had gone unbeaten for 10 years over 400 metres freestyle, and she blitzed her away. You look at some of those winning times. She won the 100 metres backstroke. Alice Tye, over 8 seconds. That's huge. Over 2 seconds in that 400 metres freestyle as well. So, you know, she's got to be on our list for Best British Sportswoman.
And the only thing that you can say is at least 2020 is coming along, and she hasn't won an individual Paralympic medal yet, but she's nailed on, one assumes, in Tokyo. And you think of the profile that they will get during those championships, that she should get that recognition in 2020. But for me, I think she's definitely on this shortlist, as you rightly say. Dina Asher-Smith, we've talked about so many times. You know, 200-metre gold world champion, 2 silvers in the World Championships as well. First ever British athlete to win 3 medals in Doha at the World Championships. Katarina Johnson-Thompson, you know.
I've beaten the drum for Katarina Johnson-Thompson on so many occasions. I think so many people have majored on what Dina Asher-Smith has done. Katarina's achievements, a lot of people, I think, in the public eye, has been eclipsed. And I think, actually, in terms of the pure athleticism of being a world heptathlon champion, 4 PBs across the events, I'm surprised she's not received more plaudits than she has.
And the demons that she's put behind her as well now, as well, in her own kind of confidence. Yep. And then Hannah Cockcroft as well should be in that list as well. 11-time world champion.
And I think with Hannah Cockcroft, who won another couple of golds, of course, out in Dubai, she again transcends her sport a little bit. She has broken through with the public. She is an infectious character. And I think, obviously, since 2012, and the profile of our para athletes have gone through the roof, and I've spoken about this before, I want to, in a way, stop making that distinction between the para athletes and so-called able-bodied athletes. I just want to consider them all as athletes. Yeah. Now, because I think that's what their achievements should be considered. And Hannah Cockcroft's achievements stand up against all of those people that we mentioned, Alice Ty, Dina Asher-Smith and Katarina Johnson-Thompson. So, let me pin you down.
As Smokey once said...
Oh, where are we going with this?
Who the beep is Alice? I think we all know who Alice Ty is, and she is our British sportswoman of the year.
I think we agree on that one. Woo-hoo! So a clink of the glasses. There we go. So we've agreed on two out of the three.
Not
interesting.
Bad.
Can I just go back? Because I've obviously really pushed for Katarina Johnson-Thompson on previous
You're
podcasts.
You're defending yourself now.
So a lot of people may accuse me of going back on that. What I would say is that Katarina Johnson-Thompson and Dina Asher-Smith, both nominated by the BBC, both nominated in the same award for the Sunday Times Sportswoman of the Year. So I was pushing KJT against Dasha in those categories. We're including Hannah and Alice in this as well, and that's why I think, for me, Alice eclipses KJT this time around.
Fully justified. Well done.
Phew. Got out of that one. So let's go to the International Sportswoman of the Year. And I think one major sporting event for women's sport this year stood out for me above most, and that was the Women's World Cup football.
Anything but footy, though.
Yes, but we did make the disclaimer at the start that we would, on Anything But Footy, cover the Lionesses, because we are all about covering...
Team GB.
Yeah, Team GB, Para GB are our two sort of main building blocks, our pillars, if you like, that we've built the podcast on. Team GB will field a women's football team in Tokyo. And we're all about talking about sports that we don't think get the coverage. And, you know, to go right back to when we started this a year ago, a little bit retrospectively, we said what we didn't want to sit here and discuss was managerial merry-go-rounds.
Yep.
When we talk about Jose Mourinho or Unai Emery, we didn't want to be talking about transfer tittle-tattle, who's going where in January. We wanted to talk about achieving sports, men and women, Paralympic level, at Olympic level, and the Lionesses for me. And what a breakthrough year it's been for the Lionesses. What a breakthrough year it's been for women's football. And, you know, that a lot of people in the world of football, and both you and I go to a lot of football,
yeah.
and we're not anti-football, we've always said that. A lot of people at the start of the season, well, no major finals this year. What are we going to do this summer? Premier League's ending. It's going to be months to the football. and actually, we had on BBC One and BBC Two a live World Cup in our time zone, prime time, that caught the public imagination. And that's why, going back to the award, Sportswoman of the Year, I think you've got to look at two American footballers, and I think Alex Morgan scored a lot of the goals. He's one of them, but the one that everyone was talking about was Megan Rapinoe.
I like her because she told Trump where to go.
Yeah, and Piers Morgan.
And that's happy. I'm happy for both of those. That she could just win it for my point of view. But no, look, seriously, she's a World Cup winner. She's a Golden Ball winner. She's the Golden Boot winner, and she captured the imagination as well as the team capturing the imagination. And I think she is definitely up there. So I'm happy for her to be on the shortlist. The rules can be broken.
Yep.
For sportswomen.
Who
and I
else?
Think she is a good bet. Simona Halep. I was doing some research and I was like, oh yeah, I forgot that she won Wimbledon. And I've always liked Simona Halep when she won the French Open a few years back, and she's been world number one for a year, but couldn't quite do it at another Grand Slam. And winning a second Grand Slam is such an achievement. And she was so thrilled.
You say that like you've done it.
Yeah. I feel like I have at times, watching Andy Murray at times, but and Tim Henman before that. It is an achievement.
Fred Perry before that.
Yeah, quite. And she crushed Serena Williams in 56 minutes in the Wimbledon final. And again, I think as a sporting moment and something that she achieved, and she, her mum was delighted to be at Wimbledon because Wimbledon's massive in Romania and stuff. So I think that was someone that I'd kind of forgotten about, who I wanted to bring in into the shortlist. And then from our kind of athletics point of view, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce, Alison Felix, two really big worldwide stars who, you know, have come back from being mothers. Well, they're still mothers.
Yeah.
They've come back from giving birth and delivering. And the pictures of Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce with her son after she won the 100-meter gold in Doha and going around the track and having the interviews was a great sight. And Alison Felix is up there with Usain Bolt. She's won as many major medals as Usain Bolt and, again, doesn't get that recognition.
No, she's been an absolutely fantastic ambassador for a sport. Her medal tally, Alison Felix, I think speaks for itself. You know, I think when you compare her record to, and we've said this before, Usain Bolt, Michael Johnson, it really does stand up there. And I think the other thing, you know, and what I think we've also tried to reflect with these is people that have gone above and beyond their sport. And I think Alison Felix speaking out against Nike and other people, sportswear manufacturers and sporting authorities this year over the issue of getting pregnant and, you know, having finances cut off and things, speaking out on behalf of her sex, on behalf of women everywhere and her fellow female athletes again, makes her a very, very worthy inclusion.
But there's one person that's probably missing.
Yeah.
I think we might say would be named sportswoman of the world.
Well, I was just, before we get onto her, I was just going to mention one other person, Katie Taylor, the boxer.
Yeah.
You know, became a two-weight world champion in 2019 in Manchester as well. Her professional record, if you like, since she turned pro, she was one of those like Nicola Adams that kind of broke through as far as most people are concerned in 2012. 6 wins by knockout, 9 by decision, no losses. So, again, you know, I think just worthy of inclusion, but
yep.
I know who you were going on to speak about, and that is Simone Biles.
Yeah, and like I said about Adam Peaty, it's not Olympic year. So next year when she wins more Olympic gold medals, she will be, profile will be bigger. But 5 world gymnastic golds in this year alone.
In Stuttgart in one championship is phenomenal.
Her record 5th all-round title as well. Which, you know, every couple of years, if you're delivering that, is incredible. She's only 22.
That's amazing when you think she seems to have been around for a long
ages.
Time, doesn't she?
I mean, I remember her very early in 2012 and then obviously massively in 2016. But, yeah, for me, I can't see past that performance and that peak of performance. And delivering when you need to deliver, because that's the other thing, you know, all of these people we've talked about deliver when they need to, but you have to get it even more precise, I think, in gymnastics.
We've talked there about a really good spectrum of, you know, really outstanding sportswomen from across the globe, but I come down to the same name again as you. I think we're agreeing once more on Simone Biles as our sportswoman of the year as far as the global sporting world is concerned.
And I'm delighted to say she can join us at that.
No, she's not here in Clerkenwell in the pub, but we'll have another gulp of the beer. This is essentially our Christmas party you're listening to. John's half a pint in. I'm about a third of a pint in. It's our inaugural Anything But Footy Awards. We've halfway through. We've done 4. And I just want to mention then our next award, which is our British Team of the Year.
Now you've got 2 teams on here that are football.
Well, yeah, and I was just going to say, you know, at this time of year when people play that game, where if they hear Wham! Last Christmas, you now need to warn them you're going to play it so that they can leave the shop or turn off the radio. I'm going to warn the Anything But Footy listeners that for the next 20 seconds I'm going to talk about football.
Boo.
Liverpool winning the Champions League.
Yeah.
Great. Comeback against Barcelona.
Yeah.
Really poor final, so I can't elevate them any further than that mention. Manchester City winning a first ever domestic quadruple. No team, even the Fergie dynasty, the great Liverpool team of the 80s, not able to buy their way, win the 4 domestic trophies.
We'll leave that to somebody else.
You could switch back on now, although we are going to mention football again with the Lionesses. They've got to be on the list, surely.
Yeah, they have to be on the list because obviously they finished 3rd in the... No, they finished 4th.
Lost
in the 3rd place
playoff.
Lost
to Sweden, yeah.
I think they did well at the World Cup. I'm not sure they quite achieved what they wanted to achieve. And Phil Neville said that, which I'm not sure a manager should say.
And their form since hasn't
been
fantastic.
Has not been
but
amazing.
Going back to the conversation we had earlier, for 3 weeks in the summer... We got excited, not just about football, about watching England in a major tournament, about watching women's football. We dared to dream.
Yeah, and attendances have increased in the Women's Premier League as well, which is important. But for me, there's only one winner in this.
Yeah, the only other team I would mention would be the England netball team. They did finish 3rd. in a home World Championships in Liverpool, won the bronze medal, lost to New Zealand in the semi-finals, beat South Africa for the third place, which I think would be a phenomenal achievement for the England netball team if they hadn't, in the previous year, won the gold medal in such dramatic circumstances in the semi-final and then the final on the Gold Coast. It was like they went to Australia and they took on, with the Commonwealth Games, all the best netball nations in the world. They won it in what like was a movie in the semi-final. You could imagine that final point being in slow motion. And then the sequel, when they did it again in the final. But then they came home and didn't defend it. And that, you know, I think finishing third in a World Cup, brilliant performance. But it was eclipsed by their earlier achievements. So, again, like you, I think I'm coming back to one team as far as our British Team of the Year is concerned.
Yeah, and I think we're saying it's the England men's cricket team.
We are saying it's the England men's cricket team.
Never won the World Cup before.
Nope.
Many chances. I can remember watching them in their pyjamas in 1992, England against Pakistan.
I remember that because it was on satellite television. And at the last minute, there was like a deal done to give 30 minutes of highlights for like a special BBC Sports Night programme. But I can remember, and again, I'm not a big cricket fan, but I remember listening on the bus to school, listening to that final on the radio, and then looking forward to watching 30 minutes of it on the television later that night. And this time, the deal was done to get that terrestrial TV audience, and that was, I think, very important.
I think it was. I mean, there was a lot of pressure to do it on home soil. We talked about the netball girls not quite matching the expectations, probably to win the World Cup. But those England cricketers, and when they, I think they lost midway through the first stage, and there was a few question marks. But although no one was particularly watching in the UK, it was sold out, but it wasn't front and centre until we really got to the semi-finals.
Yeah,
and
it
final.
Took a long time to get going.
I mean, it's a long competition because there's a lot of matches, isn't
it? And then, but everyone then did start talking about it. And in fact, the Rugby Union World Cup, which happened obviously this year as well, and England, fantastic win in the semis over New Zealand, then came up short in the final, would probably have been a contender in most other years. But the Rugby Union World Cup seemed to build even before it started. There was hype about it, but that wasn't the same in the summer. We were still hyped to think by the Women's World Cup that we'd seen and Wimbledon and all those other big sporting events that happen in the summer. It took a bit of time just for us to get into cricket, but suddenly cricket was the new football.
And Ben Stokes, obviously the superhero, we've talked about him before. The super over, whatever that was.
Yeah,
no one had a clue.
Like I said, it was extra time, penalty, sudden death, and then something else, wasn't it? And that moment, obviously, you know, in that final ball, taking off the bales as New Zealand were going for their second run.
That was crazy.
Absolute drama that I heard about later because I was in Stockton High Street watching cycling.
And then the Ashes come back. You know, they were, again, it looked like they were going to lose the Ashes. So Australia retained it, but that comeback, and everyone calls it the Botham Ashes. I think probably it will be known as the Stokes Ashes, that, but also bespeckled or bespectacled Jack Leach.
Yep.
You know, him defending that last wicket was incredible to see too. So it wasn't just a one man team. It was across different categories of cricket as well. One day and Test match as well. For me, they are the team of the year.
Time to charge the glasses because we agree again on our British team of the year, which we are awarding to the England cricket team.
Wow.
Who are away, obviously, on a tour over the winter. So not here to collect their award and not on satellite either. And no video message. So let's move on to our international team of the year. Maybe they've bothered themselves to turn up. I don't know. We talked about the USA football team, the women's football team, winning, of course, the World Cup in France, beating the Netherlands in the final, beat England in the semi-final, basically beating Thailand by a cricket score, 13-0 in the group stages as well. Great achievement from the US football team. You're a big tennis fan, and I love the tennis, but my main focus in the summer is the golf. And I loved watching the Solheim Cup this year. Captain by Katrina Matthew, who of course was a history-making golfer in Rio, part of the British team. Charlie Hull, who was on Team GB with her, was part of that Solheim Cup team at Glen Eagles with Georgia Hall, who was a Women's Open winner year before. Jodie Shadoff, Bronte Law, all English. There was a Scottish golfer there. We had a Spanish, Dutch, Norwegian, French, German, and Swedish golfer. So a real European lineup in this year where Europe has dominated so many headlines. But I'm glad that for one afternoon, the story on Europe and all the discussion about Europe was going down to a really exciting singles competition. And Europe having to win their last three singles matches to take that 14.5 to 13.5 points. And, you know, we've spoken a great deal about gender equality and gender inequality. And that's going to be a discussion point on another Anything But Footy special, where we're going to be looking ahead to the next Tokyo Olympics, which you'll be able to hear over the new year period. And if the IOC are trying to get gender equality and get rid of gender inequality, the division, if you like, between the Solheim Cup and the Ryder Cup and the profile that one gets compared to the other is a little bit unequal for me. So,
and that's my issue with it. I just didn't see it.
Yeah.
And I didn't get enough exposure. I knew I was on the radio. Well, I just didn't hear about it.
The Ryder Cup obviously dominates national broadcasts. It's on Five Live from 9 in the morning to 8 at night. It's on Talk Sport. It's on Sky. You've got 3 hours of highlights on the BBC of an evening. The Solheim Cup doesn't get that coverage, and unfortunately then that really exciting afternoon of golf was missed by a lot of people. But as a golf fan and a golf aficionado, I have to highlight that achievement for our international team, and it was a truly international team as well.
South Africa men's rugby team, we've touched on earlier as well. I mean, they overpowered the favourites England, particularly in the second half in that final. An inspiring story of the first black captain as well, Khaleesi, that we've mentioned. But I wanted to mention Japan as well as a rugby team, because they played brilliantly. I mean, they easily got through to the quarterfinals despite the hoo-ha over.
Lost to South Africa, and of course,
in the knockout stages. But they put on a great show, and I think it means that Tokyo 2020 is going to be mightily impressive as well.
Yeah, and you know, I think I would say then to the people in 2019 that knocked the awarding of the World Athletics Championships to Doha, that sometimes you can't send sporting events to the same strongholds. The Rugby Union World Cup can't always be staged in the British Isles, France, Australia or New Zealand.
Or South Africa.
At some point, it's going to have to go to Argentina to grow the game. It might have to go to Romania if Romania are going to step up to the Six Nations.
The USA.
It might have to be hosted by the USA, Italy, you know, or whatever. And it was Japan's turn to step up this time. They did a fantastic job of hosting, which you mentioned as well. The team obviously got a boost from being the host nation as well. And I wasn't there, but I know a lot of people that were there and spoke to a lot of people that were there. And they all said it was fantastic. But if I was to be pushed on my team of the year for the fact that it just transcended sport and brought back all those memories from the mid-90s, when Nelson Mandela in Ellis Park in Johannesburg, and you know, and all that we've seen the film and everything else from South Africa winning the Rugby World Cup, then I would give it to the South African Rugby Union team this time around.
So can I be controversial?
Go on.
And say, not with my England hat on, that the England cricket team should win this category as well. Because if you were New Zealand, you had to sit back and go, wow, okay, yeah, we've just beaten by a better team, which is one of the things I loved about the Cricket World Cup final, was that the Kiwis said that afterwards. They were like, it's just one of those things, they were just beaten by someone better. And the Aussies as well were beaten in the Ashes. I have a feeling that we could say that England cricket win Team of the Year and British Team of the Year.
England, if they'd gone to Australia or they'd gone to New Zealand or South Africa and won the World Cup, I'd be inclined to agree with you, but I think the fact that they won it on a home pitch probably went in their favour a little bit. And that's why the fact that South Africa went to what is an unusual territory.
Because they'd only won it before.
At home.
They won it in France, though, didn't they? Yeah, they won it in France as well.
But to go to Japan, where, you know, test nations don't regularly go and compete. Yeah. And as I said, that achievement of transcending the sport for an afternoon and having a black captain.
Jack Leach doesn't do it for you.
No. Having a black captain lifting that trophy that we've seen lifted before. I think with this one we'll have to disagree. Second category we've disagreed on, so there'll be no charging of the glasses
no
this
charging.
Time.
Sorry.
I'm going for South Africa, you go for England, I go for rugby union, you go for cricket.
I'm going for cricket. Double win for cricket. So we've got two to go.
Yep. Best British moment. I would now give this one to the cricket team. I just don't think there's been a sporting moment in 2019 as that final run attempt that New Zealand had to win that World Cup final.
Katarina Johnson-Thompson?
It's for me, it's...
Those personal bests.
It's not a moment.
It is for her, to be fair.
It is for her, yeah. And
as
you know,
as Martin McCutcheon said, this is my moment.
Perfect moment. We've really, really lost it here at the inaugural awards, the Christmas party.
These songs coming up by the DJ later.
Two thirds of a pint. He's quoting ex-EastEnders number one singles from the late 1990s. To get back onto topic, Jason Roy's throw and Joss Butler taking the bails off is a moment. Now, during the general election campaign, there was a lot of talk about the English language and you know, there's lots of talk about what the word more might mean or whatever, and literal meanings of things. So I'm going to choose the word moment and major on that and go, as a moment, that, for me, eclipses the achievements of a two-day campaign for Katarina Johnson-Thompson.
So Andy Murray, broken down in tears in Melbourne.
Told this story before. I had a nap one afternoon in January. I woke up, put the radio on. I thought he'd passed away. Such were the eulogies to him and his career. Fortunately, within about 40 minutes, I found out it was just that it looked like his career might be over. Of course, it wasn't.
And that's an incredible moment for him. And if you've watched, I haven't watched the Amazon program yet, but read a lot about it. And the pain that he went through to get back to where he wants to get back to. The doubles title at Queen's with Feliciano Lopez. As a tennis fan, was one of those moments. It was a great week of tennis action and a great final to see that. Seeing him back at Wimbledon, his first ATP tour title in 31 months. I think he needs to be nominated, Andy Murray. We haven't talked enough about him in our podcast today. So I'm saying that. And then with my Norfolk hat on, my Sophie McKinna moment. So the World Championships in Doha. Shot put is not the most glamorous finals that people talk about, but actually it's there as a World Championship gold medal to be won. There's an Olympic gold medal to be won. And Sophie is someone who I really, really respect because she went out there. I met her at the team announcement and she was going to go out there. She'd had her best season throughout the summer. She then went to Doha and she threw a personal best in the semis, in the qualifiers, to reach the final. But not only that, but then book her Olympic spot as well at the same time. And to do that while holding down two jobs as well. She's not funded by the lottery.
And has turned down funding for another year.
Yeah.
She has been offered funding, but has decided to keep the status quo as
because it's working for her.
Yeah.
And I think there's so much... It's too easy to say lottery funding is the reason for every success, because it's not. It's what works for you, and she's worked it out. And I think, again, with your moment description, for me, that moment, that picture of Sophie celebrating her success is an iconic moment. And I did cover Doha a lot, and I'll be openly biased about it because she's from Norfolk as well. But I think that was a great moment.
And I just want to mention one other thing, and I'm completely contradicting what I was saying here about the cricket and that just being a moment, and that's my definition of a moment. You mentioned lottery funding, and the body, obviously, that's in charge of handing that out is UK Sport, been tremendously successful, not just on winning medals, but bringing big sporting events to this country as well. And we've seen big sporting events come to this country this year with the Netball World Cup, for example, and an event that I covered a lot this year was the World Road Cycling in Yorkshire. Mm. And I thought, although...
It made you ill.
It made me ill, but I mean, stood in the rain in Harrogate for most of the week. Gave me, if you listen back to some of the episodes after that, a little bit of a croaky throat. I just thought there were some great moments in that because the weather was so atrocious. You had cyclists cycling through what appeared to be small rivers at times. Some amazing images if you want to go and away and Google some of the images of the cyclists. I thought, as a moment, as a sporting week in Yorkshire, building on the Grand Depart from 2014, the subsequent editions of the Tour de Yorkshire, I have to just say, you know, hats off Yorkshire. Welcome to Yorkshire, the agency. And hats off to UK Sport for bringing another major sport event and bringing, you know, all the world's best cyclists to the country. I thought it was brilliant.
Yeah, but I think we're agreeing that the cricket. England cricket team.
Having said all that, the Cricket World Cup, we charge our glasses again and say cheers. And I think we are agreeing the best British sporting moment of the year was the Cricket World Cup final.
Indeed.
So it brings us on to our final award.
Yes.
Literally the best sporting moment of the year from, well, our viewpoints, really. Go on, you start.
Well, I mean, we could talk about everything that we've already talked about. I mean, Rafa Nadal and even the Wimbledon final, you know, with Djokovic.
Dina Asher Smith. At the World Championships, not just winning her three medals, but helping fellow athletes that were injured. That was a photograph, a moment, a picture that went around the world. Everyone went, my word, she's not just very, very good at running. She's not just very, very quick around the bend. She's not just lightning fast from, you know, gun to finish line, but she's obviously a decent human being as well. That's got to be there or thereabouts.
Yep. And Adam Peaty breaking his world record. And
Elliot Kipchoge, a two-hour, sub-two-hour marathon in Vienna.
Serious, all of them. And then I've got a few more to chuck in. So Coco Gauff.
Yep.
At Wimbledon,
the
youngster,
teenager.
15 years of age, smiling at SW19. That's what I remember, just her smile.
I think, and, you know, with Coco Gauff, I think it brings for me memories of, like, Jennifer Capriati and Anna Kournikova, and there are obviously others sort of before my time, but those were two in sort of my...
Martina Hingis.
Martina Hingis, of course. How could I forget? In my sort of younger years, watching those break through as teenagers and coming through and having fantastic success. And Boris Becker, of course. In 85. Yeah. Probably my first memory of Wimbledon as a 17-year-old. So, you know, that's another production line moment of a teenager doing fantastically well at Wimbledon.
We mentioned Shane Lowry, but Andy Ruiz Jr. beating Anthony Joshua. No one saw that. That was a moment.
Well, no one saw it when they looked at him, did they? It was like the bloke that stood on the doors outside your local pub knocking Anthony Joshua over.
Anthony Joshua didn't think he was going to do it either.
No, well, something obviously, you know, didn't go right in the build-up and the fight for Anthony Joshua there. So, yeah, well, Anthony Ruiz Jr. was on my list as part of the panel for the Laureus World Sporting Awards. So, you know, he is certainly someone I'd never heard of if we'd sat here 12 months ago in this lovely little pub in the central London that we're in doing this at the moment. I think he's worthy of inclusion and mention.
And then Tiger Woods.
Yeah, well, I know you've sort of banged the drum for Tiger quite a lot this year. You know, I don't want to hold his personal indiscretions against him forever, but the stardust, the glitter around Tiger Woods just slightly less illuminated than it once was.
But that's the incredibleness of it, that he literally fell off a golf cart.
Yeah.
And he has clawed his way back. And you don't have to like the man, but you can respect appreciate to get back to a Masters winning level.
I just think that he's had so much attention for what's been some big failings in his personal life. And you've got someone like Max Parrott, who's a snowboarder, who's battled really, really serious injury this year and come back to be a contender again and win at the X Games. And, you know, that was a personal setback that was not of his own doing with Max Parrott. That was just, you know, a very, very serious illness, which, you know, he's come back from, he's come through, and, you know, he's back winning medals. And I just, it sticks in my throat a little bit that, you know, we will give Tiger Woods, a sportswear manufacturer might give Tiger Woods several more million for winning the Masters because of what we've seen in the past a little bit. And someone like Max Parrott gets forgotten. And that's why I wanted to mention him.
You've mentioned him. So what are we going to agree on?
Well, I'm going to have to say my international sporting moment of the year is the same as my British sporting moment.
So it's cricket.
It's the Cricket World Cup final, just because it was so dramatic. It was like something you wouldn't have dared to write if you were making the cricket version of Goal, a terrible Newcastle movie.
Was Alan Shearer in that?
Probably. Anna Friel was. I remember that. If you were making
Michael Owen. Oh no, that was the Real Madrid one.
That cricket movie. You wouldn't have dared to write that storyline. So, great British moment. And for me, the international sporting moment of the year was England winning the Cricket World Cup.
I think you're right. But I don't think that's just us with our English glasses on. I think if you were outside the world watching that event, then you'd expect that we would say that was our sporting moment of the year, if you like.
So, there you go. We haven't agreed on everything. But if we were just to run through some of the names. Have we agreed on that one?
Yeah.
We have. There we go. We've agreed on that one. So we haven't agreed on everything, but some of the names that we've honoured in our inaugural awards. Adam Peaty as our best British sportsman, which we agreed on. Eliud Kipchoge, I think we agreed on.
Did you go
for Tiger?
Rafa.
Rafa, that was it. Rafa and Eliud Kipchoge for international sportsmen. Alice Tye, course, for best British sportswoman, best international sportswoman, Simone Biles. Team, the England cricket team, have scooped a few of our awards.
Yep.
The international team, I went for South Africa.
I went for England.
You went for England. And then the British moment and international moment, we both went for the England cricket team and the Cricket World Cup final. And that concludes the inaugural Anything But Footy Woo! Awards for 2019. Cheers, John.
Thank you very
don't
much.
Don't forget, of course, Anything But Footy, the regular weekly update on everything Olympic and Paralympic. We'll be back with a New Year special, and how apt and appropriate that at the start of 2020 we'll be looking forward to the 2020 Olympics and looking at what's new and what's fresh and what's different for the next edition of the Olympic Games. And then, of course, we'll be building up to the Olympics and the Paralympics, of course, all the way through until the game. So it's... well, just basically for us to say, have a great Christmas and a happy new year. And thank you very much for listening.
Merry Christmas.